Okay, so topic of today's class is going to be dedicated towards the harmonized tariff schedule of the United States. It is one of the major pillars. Remember, the pillars which comprise the CBE exam, customs broker examination, are entry, then customs broker responsibilities, and which includes not only section part 111 but also includes penalties, for example. It also includes the record keeping requirements, and of course huge and very controversial to many students, harmonized tariff schedule of the United States. So HTS, abbreviated as HTSUS. So our goal is to get a head start over here, because this unlike this area and this area, which mostly are dealt with in CFR and directives, this one is a subject to the whole new book. This very big, thick book, which really determines the duty, it determines the it gives a classification, it really goes to the heart of the country of origin questions, and this is almost like a topic on its own within customs broker exam. So let's dive right in and just see how before we even start having a substantive discussion, what we need to do is we need to be familiar with the HTSUS structure. So, going back to the history, classification and the the determination of duty, applicable tariff, etc., was not always determined according to harmonized tariff schedule itself. The concept of the harmonized tariff schedule can be traced back all the way back to the 1970s. In 1970s, and the United States was a major pusher of this initiative, the goal was to get a group of countries, international community, if you will, or international trade community, and get those countries to agree on certain principles which will harmonize the international trade. And one of those, there were many principles, and it was done under the auspices of General Agreement of on Tariff and Trade, GATT, which of course became later in 1995, the WTO, right? So this was lurking in the background, and this came into the foreground in the United States. So the decision, the word H, which means harmonized among group of countries. So a bunch of countries came to the table and agreed, and the agreement was finalized by 1988. So historically speaking, it was not that long ago. Which was where a bunch of countries got together and finally agreed on terms and conditions. By 1989, harmonized, the United States Congress approved this agreement, and this became the law. So now you can safely say that HTSUS is a law. It is a legal mandate which is applicable to everyone who is signed to the Harmonized Convention, HS Convention. And HS Convention it was signed in Europe, not in the United States. The major body which oversaw the convention was called World Customs Organization, also known abbreviated as WCO. And this is where all the international level discussions take place. And the United States, as a member, they do have a representative which goes there and provides opinion on behalf of the people of the United States. So this is a big umbrella. Once it comes down to the United States, of course, Congress must approve it. Once it is approved, it becomes applicable on both sides, on the U.S. customs side and on the importer side, because the same law applies to everyone. So let's looking at the outline. Looking in the, at the outline, we can see that the agreement was reached, and most of the agreement was at the international level was made at six digit level, because the HTSUS harmonized tariff schedule of the United States is made up of 10 digits. So almost every commodity, as we shall later see, but almost every commodity can be slapped on with a label, and that label has 10 digits. And those 10 digits are the harmonized tariff schedule of the United States, which drive the duty, which drive the classification, can also have other repercussions, such as requirements for other government agencies, such as United States Department of Agriculture, in the context of fees, for example. They determine whether, for example, a Rosberry fee applies based on a harmonized tariff schedule. The clothing itself also bears the fees, such as the cotton fee, if this is made out of cotton, and the amount of cotton fees charged is assessed based on those 10 numbers. So those 10 numbers are hugely important. Of course, locally, nationally, in the United States, we really responsible for the last four. Most of the customs broker exam questions, they focus on last two, which is responsibility of the United States. The United States is free to adopt any digits at its will, and they do not have an international weight. This is more questionable, because why is it questionable? Because if you read the convention, you will see that the United States agrees to have a system harmonized to the subheading level. Well, this is also a subheading, but if you look at the legal documents, if you look at the opinions of the Court of International Trade, you look at the customs own interpretation of the harmonized tariff system, you find that they also recognize that international level really goes to six digits, where the remainder is left to the United States. So, out of the free trade agreement, not a free trade, but out of the HS convention, out of this international agreement, which mandates, which requires the United States to go with what is internationally agreed, we have the system which has HTS, the big fat book, and that big fat book is really summarized over here. And you can harmonize tariff schedule of the United States. And the summary can be really explained by looking at the table of contents. So how this is, by the way, all published online. The agency that is responsible for maintaining is the United States USITC, which is United States International Trade Commission. So they are responsible for maintaining, publishing, updating, safekeeping the electronic version of harmonized tariff schedule of the United States. And the way you get to this is you go to the main website, lawcustoms.com, and at the bottom right corner you have this link, harmonized tariff schedule of the United States, right here. And if you click on it, this window will pop up, which will direct you to there. So, of course, on the exam, you will not be able to use the electronic copy. You will have to stick with the paper version. But as you practice, and for the purpose of the class, I'd rather have this on the screen electronically in a digital format rather than just bring this back big fat book and try to flip the pages and show you the letters. So this electronic form that we use is really for the convenience, but at the exam you will have to use the paper copy. So the HS convention says that at the international level we agree to have the following things which will make the United States follow if adopted. So several things that apply as an outgrowth of this convention is general rules of interpretation, also abbreviated throughout the course as GRIs, general rules of interpretation. And this is like a constitution of the harmonized tariff schedule. It is specific and at the same time is broad. It is written in such a way as to be able to enable the classifying party to be flexible in terms of classifying certain things as opposed to others. For example, using the harmonized tariff schedule, one can say, for example, if you hold this piece of paper and you look at it, it looks like paper, so you classify it as paper. But then it gives you enough flexibility to say, hey, wait a minute, this piece of paper has printing on it. And because it's printed, it may also be may be classified as the printed matter, for example. So one would be paper, Articles of Paper, Chapter 48. Another one is printed matter, Harmonized Tariff Schedule, Chapter 49. So, how do customs examiners test students, test prospective, test exam takers on this topic? Well, this is one example that came from the past, and they, customs examiners really say, all right, so what is the deal with 9th and 10th digits of the HTS number? We remember that there are 10, really 10 digits. Sometimes there are 8, there are exceptions to the rule. And those 8 digits really come to life in the special chapters. The special chapters are located at the end of the harmonized tariff schedule. They are usually called chapter 89, I'm sorry, 98, and chapter 99. And they have special legislative purposes, special exceptions made as a result of negotiations. Since we live in a world where politics play a huge role, those, I would say, are more political chapters. So how do we answer this? Which of the following is true about 9th and 10th digits of the 10-digit tariff numbers, which of course refers to the United States? And as you can see, A is true because the digits constitute a 2-digit statistical suffix. Because very last one, going back to what we had, we can see the breakdown, and the breakdown becomes very important. So the very first thing you need to do even before you open the book is you need to realize that depending on how far you get, as far as digits are concerned, you will need to apply certain labels to them. And you need to apply labels because different rules apply to those different levels. So, for example, first 4 digits are called the heading. Then the next 4 digits are called subheading. And, of course, those subheadings are divided in the first level and the second level. And this is important because, as we shall see later, we need to evaluate when we do classification in a step-by-step analysis, and distinction between first level and second level comes to play a role. Also, at the eighth digit, at the eighth digit of the harmonized tariff schedule, you will have, generally speaking, the application of the duty, of the tariff, of the tariff rate, of the ad valorem or percentages that are applicable to the product. At that level, you will have a situation where which assigns the tariff rate. So, just as an example, let's open any chapter. Just randomly speaking, so let's do something interesting, not ore, slug, and ash, but something perhaps more interesting, such as rawhides and articles of leather, for example. And as we open up the tariff, we look at the structure, and we usually see, like over here, for example, that, let me see if I can do it a little bigger. We see that, for example, the tariff rate here is 10 digit level, but really it applies at the 8 digit level. It's not 6 digit level, but at 8th digit, you'll get the tariff rate assigned. Sometimes, if there is only 00 and nothing else, you have a 10 digit, but really at this level, you will have an associated tariff rate. Let's see if we can find some more examples. So just to show you that this is not a random type of inquiry or thought.